Hello, everyone.
Hi.
Thanks for coming out. So, guys, I directed Hamlet Act 3, Scene 1. And in case there's anyone out there that just literally doesn't know anything about Shakespeare, trust me, you know this scene. It's one of the most famous ones in Shakespeare, and I've always wanted to do my own version of it. So the story so far is Hamlet is the young prince of Denmark. He's away at college, and he gets word that his father has died. And he comes home, and his father's ghost appears to him and tells him, "I was murdered by Claudius, who has since married his mother." And once he receives word of this, he tries everything in his power to prove it, and during the process, he gets more and more and more wrapped up in this paranoid delusion of his. And so that is where the scene enters in. I wanted to do this scene since, well, forever, but last semester I took a performance class for Shakespeare, and we studied this scene for 2 weeks, all the different things that you can say with it. Because there are so many different variables, whether or not Hamlet knows who is in the room listening to him speak, whether or not he is telling the truth. There's just a whole bunch of things you can say with this, and ever since we spent those 2 weeks on it, I wanted to do this scene. So, without further ado, enjoy Hamlet.
Gracious, so please you wield the star of summit. Read on this book that it shows such an exercise may cope with loneliness. We're off to blameliness. This is too much proved that by devotion's wise vision, pious action, we do sugar or the devil himself.
Oh, 'tis too true. How smart a lash that speech doth give my conscience. The harlot's cheek, beauty with plastering art, is not more ugly to the thing that helps it than is my deed to my most painted work.
Let's withdraw. To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing and to die, to sleep no more, and by sleep to save again the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis consummation devoutly to be wished to die. To sleep. To sleep. Perchance to dream. I thirst the realm. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil, must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of such long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time? the oppressor's wrongs. The proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the loss, the lay, the insolence of office, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare body. What were farthest fair to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country, from whose bourne no traveler returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear the ills we have than go to others that we know not of. This conscience makes cowards of us all, and the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with the pale cast of thought, and enterprises of great pith and moment, with disregard, their currents turn awry, and lose the name of action. Soft you now, the fair Ophelia. Nymph in thine orisons be all thy sins remembered.
Good my lord, how does your honor for this many day?
I humbly thank you. Well, well, well.
My lord, I have remembrances of yours that I have longed to redeliver. I pray you now receive them.
No, no, no. I never gave you all.
My honored lord, you know quite well you did. And with them words of so sweet breath composed as make the things more rich. Their perfume lost, take these again! For to the noble mind, rich gifts wax poor when givers prove unkind. There, my lord.
Are you honest?
My lord.
Are you fair?
But me, your lord.
If you be honest and fair, your honesty should have did no discourse to your beauty.
Could beauty, my lord, have better commerce than honesty?
Aye, truly. For the force of beauty will sooner transform honesty from what it is to a bond than the power of honesty can translate beauty to his likeness. This was some time a paradox, but now time gives it proof. I did love you once.
Indeed, my lord, you made me believe so.
You should not believe me, for virtue cannot so inoculate our old stock, but we must ravish of it. I loved him thus.
I was born to see.
Get thee to another. Why wouldst thou be a breeder of sinners? I am myself indifferent honest, yet I could accuse myself of such things that it were better my mother had not borne. I am very proud, revengeful, ambitious, with more offenses at my neck than I have thoughts to put them in, imagination to give them shape, or time to act them in. What should fellows such as I do thralling between earth and heaven? We are errant knaves all. Believe none of us. Where is your father?
At home, my lord.
Then let the doors be shut upon him, that he may play the fool nowhere but in his own house. Farewell.
Welcome, you sweet heavens!
If thou dost marry, I'll give thee this plague for thy dower. Be thou as chaste as ice, as pure as snow, thou shalt not escape cat. Go thy ways to another, and quickly too, farewell. Or if thou must needs marry, marry a fool, for wise men know what monsters you make of them. Go thy ways to another. Farewell.
O heavenly powers, restore him.
I have heard of your paintings too well enough. God gives you one face, and you make yourselves another. You amble, you jig, you list, and you nickname God's creatures and make your wantonness your ignorance. Go to! I'll no more on it. It hath made me mad. I say we shall have no more marriages. Those that are married already, all but one shall live. The rest shall keep as they are. Another.
harsh. That unmatched form and feature of blown youth blessed him with ecstasy! Oh, woe is me. To have seen what I have seen. And see what I see.
Love, his affections do not that way tend, nor he spake.
Shall be so. Madness in great ones must not unwatched go.